Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I would like to ask Vice Chair Bill Ashley to offer a prayer and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Okay, let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time thanking you for being in our lives. We thank you for all that you do. We ask you to be with us and guide us in the way we handle the people's business of Alamance County tonight. We just ask for your blessings and in your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Bill. Now we'll officially call tonight's meeting to order. We'd like to welcome all of you to this, the first meeting in February 2012. And the first order of business is for the commissioners to review and approve the agenda. And all of you can have a copy of the agenda. Commissioners, are there any proposed changes to the agenda? Hearing none, if you would review the consent agenda, are there any items on the consent agenda that you would like removed? Hearing none, we'll have a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second? Thank you, Eddie. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Agenda is approved. Now time for public comments. We have one. I'd like to call on John Oakes, resident of Burlington. John, welcome to you. Come forward.
John, welcome.
Hey, good evening, hey, commissioners. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak this evening. It is unfortunate that we have reached a point in our history as a country that we find ourselves faced with having to write and adopt a public policy regarding invocations at public meetings. Though it may be politically correct and now necessary to do so, it is not historically correct or necessary. Even though I appreciate and agree with your rationale and reasoning to do so at this time in our history. The extreme effort by those to eliminate this tradition in our society under the veil of constitutional objections is not only historically incorrect, it fringes on absurd. And all rational citizens that have the most modest understanding of our country and its history know this. Those that suggest or infer that the First Amendment suggests or implies when it states, quote, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, etc., end quote, is stating or implying that our Constitution does not permit a public prayer at any governmental proceeding at any level of government, are at best misinformed of our Founding Fathers' words and intent pertaining to this matter. At worst, it is a direct attempt on their behalf to subvert and mislead people as to our history as a country and our Founding Fathers' thoughts, beliefs, and opinions pertaining to God, faith, prayer, not only privately, but publicly. Furthermore, and equally as important, it is a direct misrepresentation of fact of the history of the United States to suggest or imply that aggregately, when the issue of God was being pondered or discussed privately or publicly, that the founders of the United States were not inferring, thinking, or referring to the God of the Judeo-Christian faith and tradition. And although it is politically incorrect to state that the founders of the United States' ideas and concept of God were that of Judeo-Christian faith, it is factual and true. They were not Hindus, they were not Buddhist, they were not Muslims. This is an historical fact. I believe rational U.S. citizens welcome other religions of the world, but it is historically inaccurate to suggest or imply that our Founding Fathers were not thinking about the God of the Judeo-Christian Bible when they were pondering and discussing God. There are thousands of documents, written documentation to support this conclusion. In closing, I'll leave you with just a few from Thomas Jefferson, but I could spend a week up here. And I know no one wants that.
Nope. Sorry, John.
You're three.
Thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
Thank you for your input.
John, I agree with you 100%.
That's right.
We all do.
At this time, we have a special announcement. Y'all come in. You can sit down. You can come right up here in front if you'd like.
Saved you. Sir.
Welcome to you. We have a true celebrity among our midst tonight, and I want to take a minute and talk about a very special award and then recognize this individual. This award is from the American Simmental Association, which has to do with cattle, I learned. The American Simmental Association Board of Trustees has announced the names of three worthy recipients of the coveted World Simmental Fleckvieh Federation Golden Book Award. The honor is the organization's equivalent of the Hall of Fame induction and the highest honor bestowed by the association. Since the award was first established in 1982, 57 individuals or ranch operations have been so honored. Golden Book members of the class of 2012, who were actually recognized in January during the 44th annual meeting in Denver, included John Christensen of Wessington, South Dakota, Bob Finch of Ames, Iowa, and our very own Frank Bell of Burlington. And I'd like to read the background information before I recite the citation and ask Mr. Bell to stand. Frank Bell of Bell Farms is described as a leader, a person who makes things happen. He's given a great amounts of time to the North Carolina Simmental Association, his local cattlemen's group, his church, and many other civic groups. I'll add that he also is chairman of our own Board of Equalization and Review here at the county. Bell and his wife, Julia, who recently celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary, are the parents of a daughter and son who have presented them with four grandchildren. Born and raised near Dozier, Alabama, he moved to North Carolina in 1960, where he bred Angus cattle for the famous Y Plantation. Bell bought his first Simmental in the 1980s and has been producing Sim Angus ever since. He's a past president and board member of the NCSA, a time when he was a strong fundraiser and led the association to become more proactive in the promotion of Simmental genetics. He joined the Optimal Beef Genetics Marketing Group in the early 1990s and continued as a member of that group until dispersing his entire cow herd to Gibbs Farms of Ranburn, Alabama. He now serves as coordinator for a group of commercial breeders who cooperatively sell loads of Sim Angus feeder calves straight off the farm. This is a quote: "Having been nominated for this award surpasses any dream that I could ever have imagined. Many individuals come to mind who have made greater contributions than I, and I'm extremely honored. I would like to thank the ASA trustees for their vote of confidence and for the work that you do to promote one of the best breeds in the world. I would like to leave you with my life's philosophy by Ralph Waldo Emerson: do not follow where the path may lead. Go instead where there is no path and leave a trail." And Frank, if you would stand, I'd like to read this citation. And Julie, if you'd like to stand with him. No? Please come forward. Frank Bell, this is a citation that was issued by the American Simmental Association at their awards banquet in January. Frank Bell, owner-operator of Bell Farms in Burlington, North Carolina, has made significant contributions to the beef industry as a Simmental breeder, state association officer, and community leader. An Alabama native, Bell migrated to North Carolina in 1960, bred Angus cattle for the renowned Y Plantation. Since purchasing his first Simmental genetics in the 1980s, he joined the highly respected Optimal Beef Genetics Marketing Group and continued to promote and produce Sim Angus cattle until dispersing the entire cow herd. Currently, he serves as coordinator for a contingent of commercial breeders who cooperatively market their Sim Angus feeder calves directly off the farm. And then again, the quote from Ralph Waldo Emerson is here: "A man of many talents." This is not what Emerson said. This is after this. "A man of many talents, loving husband, doting father, proud grandfather, loyal friend, trusted advisor, and dedicated breeder, Bell and Julia, his wife of more than 50 years, are the parents of two and grandparents of four. In recognition of these contributions and service, this certificate and plaque are awarded, signifying entry into the Golden Book of the World Simmental Fleckvieh Federation, this the 15th day of January, 2012. Frank, congratulations. And your acceptance speech is limited to, what I tell you, 25 minutes?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, fellow commissioners, Mr. County Manager, and all county employees. I'm humbled that you would take this moment to share with me some of the accomplishments that I have had throughout my life. There is one more accomplishment that I'd like to see accomplished before I leave Alamance County. As all of you know, I have been privileged to be the chairman of the Equalization Review Board for three of the most trying years, I think, that there's been in the history of this county. I am happy to report that tonight we have a better department, a working department, attitudes have changed, people are more progressive, people are proud of their jobs and they're doing a good job. We have turned that around, not I, but that department, under the leadership of the present administration. I'm proud to say that we have made strides in the last 3 years. It has not been easy, folks. We have listened to hundreds of complaints, hundreds of opportunities in the tax base of this county, and rightfully so. I would covet your attention as we move forward into the months and years to come. In 2017, we will have the opportunity to make things right. We have a new revalve coming up. Folks, we got the people in place to get the job done. We are still not to the end of the road. We've got a lot of work to do. There's a lot of problems out there. I hope I live to 2017 that I can say that once and for all, Alamance County is one of the best departments in the state of North Carolina. Please give those people your attention. We need to work in that direction, and we need to do it and do it right. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. And again, I mentioned Frank serves as the chairman of the Board of Equalization and Review. That's the group. There's five of you, I believe. That's the group that gets to hear appeals and have fun with all the discussions and complaints from citizens in this county. So that is a tough job. So thank you again and congratulations. Commissioner comments. Do we have any at this time?
Other than just to thank Frank for that service he has done, because he came in at a horrible time as to head that group, and he is, without his leadership, I'm not sure we would have got through all of that. So just thank you, Mr. Bale.
Thank you, Eddie. I would like to mention a couple things. Last week was a busy week for the school system. We had the grand opening of the System Career and Technical Education Center, and it was a good turnout for the ceremony. I was a little surprised that we didn't discuss a little more at that event the role that Alamance County had in working to procure the financing and to explain where that financing came from. So I have asked Clyde if he would just take a minute. Clyde Albright, our county attorney, that worked through a lot of this documentation in obtaining the federal money, if he would just take a minute and update everyone, now that the center is open, exactly what our role was.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Following the discussions in 2009 with the school board, this board entered into a joint agreement in August of 2010 to build the new career and technical school. Alamance County's legal department, the manager, the finance folks, our outside bond counsel, BB&T, and the North Carolina Treasurer's Office worked together over many months to take advantage of the qualified school construction bonds that the federal government had issued. There were about $11 billion of those bonds issued nationwide. And we ended up with about $8.3 million. The financing closing took place September 15th of 2010. Just over $8.3 million came from these qualified construction bonds, and the debt will be serviced from the school system's existing lottery funds. The county's responsibility is $1.56 million of this debt service, which we are paying for at the rate of $130,000 a year for the next 12 years. And we achieved that by refinancing our own debt in 2009. So we saved enough money from the county's overall debt to take care of this financing of this school. And I must say, I went out there and looked at it. It's a great program. It's a great asset to this community. First high school in, what, 41 years. And I'm happy to have had a part in it.
Last high school was Cummings. Tim, what was that, 1970?
I wasn't here, but mid-70s, I believe.
Yeah, early 70s, so.
Early to mid.
Thank you, Clyde. And through the work of Clyde and the finance folks here, we really did, I think, come up with the most efficient, that is the cheapest way to provide the funding, the county's portion, as well as tap on to the federal stimulus dollars.
That's right. We're saving enough with the refinancing to pay for the school, for our part of the school.
Thank you. The other thing I wanted to mention about that, which was not mentioned at the grand opening, was we talk about the importance of economic development and the creation of jobs and the environment to create positions. If we are able to bring potential businesses into the area and show them the kind of commitment that we have to that type of center, I think that'll go a long way to making the statement that we're serious about making workforce development opportunities available. So, again, it was very nice. Two members of our school board are here tonight, Tony Rose and Patsy Simpson. Y'all did a great job, and we thank you.
Thank you.
Related to education, there also was a letter that each of us have seen from the community college relating to a probable request from the college over the next month or two for the construction of an additional facility for career and technical education. And there was some publicity about that relating to developer group that wanted to talk to them about possible space. So that'll be interesting to see what kind of analysis they come up with before they come see us. And I believe we're looking at trying to get a date together for the school board, this board, and the board of trustees at ACC to all get together in the last part of March to hear some of that. So that'll be interesting. It is my further understanding that the school, the public school officials are interested and receptive to sharing this new facility with the folks at the community college. So it'll be interesting to see what kind of additional partnerships we can develop from that. So a lot going on, a lot of positive things happening with respect to education. And the only other thing I want to say before we move on, since we are going at the end of this meeting into closed session, and some folks may not be here when we come out of that, I do want to wish happy birthday to two of our commissioners. My understanding is today is Mr. Sutton's birthday, and tomorrow is Mr. Boswell's birthday, and somehow that happens the same way every year. I don't know. So happy birthday to both of you.
Thank you very much.
So
we ain't gonna see him.
Happy birthday, birthday.
Yeah, save us on the same.
I've only had 39.
I'm right behind
you. Okay.
Frank said 38.
Hearing no other commissioner responses, we will move to the next item on the agenda, item 6, which is the Childhood Obesity Awareness Proclamation, and call on the team, looks like the Supercharge Elon University Bateman team, and I would bet that their representatives are right here. Please come forward.
Childhood obesity is a rising problem in our nation. It has more than tripled in the past 30 years, and today, 1 in 3 children are obese. In addition to the immediate health risks it poses on young people, the future health dangers that are associated with it are equally as threatening. The Elon University Bateman team believes that it's time to do something to combat the increasing number of young people who are obese. With our campaign, Supercharge Alamance, we are working to educate children, parents, teachers, and health professionals about the many risks and prevention mechanisms. Throughout the month of February, we will be visiting schools, organizations, and hosting events that will address nutrition, low-budget solutions, and physical fitness as ways to prevent the further growth of obesity in Alamance County. Therefore, we are asking that February 25th, 2012, be declared Childhood Obesity Awareness Day. By asserting this specific day, we will be one step closer to raising awareness of this issue throughout the county. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Please stay. And I've got the proclamation in front of me that I would be delighted to recite, if I may. Whereas February 25th, 2012 is Childhood Obesity Awareness Day. Whereas childhood obesity has tripled in the past 30 years. Whereas today one in three children is obese in the United States. Whereas the issue has become a significant public health problem in the United States. Whereas many health officials and experts consider childhood obesity an epidemic. Whereas according to the National Health and Nutritional Examination Survey, approximately 17% of the 12.5 million children and adolescents ages 2 to 19 years are obese. Whereas sedentary lifestyles and poor eating habits are creating a generation of Americans who will face very serious health consequences both in the near term and in the long term. Whereas according to the U.S. Center for Disease Control, in 2008, medical costs associated with obesity were estimated at $147 billion. Whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners supports the United Way of Alamance County and the 2012 Elon University Bateman team in the goal of increasing awareness among children, teenagers, and their parents of the serious short and long-term consequences of obesity, informing them of the steps they can take to adopt a healthier lifestyle and providing incentives to take such action now. Now, therefore, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners does hereby proclaim February 25th, 2012, Childhood Obesity Awareness Day throughout Alamance County and urges all agencies, localities, schools, organizations, and our citizens to recognize this day with appropriate programs and activities with the goal of promoting healthy eating and physical activity and increasing awareness of childhood obesity among individuals of all ages, adopted this sixth day of February 2012. We thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Mm-hmm.
We need a motion.
Yes, we do.
I'll make the motion.
Motion from our vice chair. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Thank you, Linda. Any discussion or comments? Thank you for doing what you're doing. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And how do we get a signed copy of these ladies? Do you have, we'll get it to her?
Is this a national thing or is this just something you girls?
I don't have the original, do I?
The Bateman competition is a nationwide sponsor competition by the Public Relations Society of America. And every year Elon sponsors a team. And each year the Bateman competition works with a national partner. So this year is the United Way. And the campaign is to increase awareness about childhood obesity. Yes,
I think
it is.
We have a United Way representative
we
back
do.
There through it.
And would you all like to introduce yourselves and maybe where you're from?
I'm Carla Fitzgerald. I'm originally from Cincinnati, Ohio, and I'm a senior at Elon.
I'm Christy Jacobson. I'm from Raleigh, and I'm also a senior.
I'm Elena Papino from Ohio, and I'm a senior as well.
I'm Shannon King. I'm from Roswell, Georgia, and I'm also a senior.
We're glad you're here.
Thank you for having us.
And two of the four of you are Buckeyes. Well, thank you all for joining us this evening. I do have the proclamation. Do you want me to give it to you so they can take it with them now, Tori? Let me do that. Pass that to her. Okay. 2010-2011 Annual Report Workforce Investment Act Report, Cheryl Ray. Cheryl, welcome. How are you?
Thank you, Commissioner. Chair, Commissioner, Commissioners. I am a human resource professional for Sports Endeavors, Inc. in Mebane. I was elected by you all last July to serve on our county's, we're a tri-county, and we'll get into where we've changed, as a private sector representative from our county for the Workforce Development Board and for the Regional Partnership Workforce Development Board. I'm here tonight to present the 2010-2011, so July 2011, 2010 to June 2011 annual reports. I delivered these previously, so great, they're already here. This year, one of the main changes for the board is we were previously a three-county board, Orange, Randolph, and Alamance County. Earlier last year, we became a five-county board, which joining Montgomery and Moore County to the partnership board due to some strategic changes on their part. They could no longer be a two-county board. One of their other counties went to another consortium, so they joined our board. Some of our highlights this year, of course, are going to be spotlighted in the book, but we do have our July annual banquet. That was in Burlington last year. We've had it in Burlington every year. We bring everyone here. This year it will be in July again, but it will be in Randolph County since we are a five county board, so we try to meet centralized. We recognized Honda Power Equipment for their initiatives with the programs and the uses of WIA, so Workforce Investment Act. So they were recognized, and of course their photos are in that book. We also recognized four citizens from Alamance County for their success. You can read their success stories in the book. Two of them, I want to say, were high school dropouts, and one's a single mother, have used the resources that this board kind of contracts out to local entities and have made a better career for themselves through overcoming some obstacles. Our county's JobLink office is the Workforce Development Board contracts this JobLink office out of the ESC here in Burlington. They saw over 18,000 citizens and helped them through various JobLink resume writing techniques, job search, that kind of stuff last year, the physical last year. In the middle of the report, you'll see the funding that our board oversees. These are federal dollars that come into the state and they get reallocated out through the 23 development workforce development boards. We had just shy of $900,000 that we allocated out, and you'll see the Alamance County breakdowns of where that money, what programs that money went into for that. Our board this year does look forward to some exciting things. We are looking right now currently at a burning glass technology to make an investment in so that our county and other counties within North Carolina, all development boards are coming together to purchase this this software technology, and we put a bid out for that, and this will be to where employers can post things, but also can set a going to Career Builder and those kind of jobs. They can all post to this one database, and our JobLink and ESC workers can help incumbent workers and job seekers use this database to go in there. So it's pretty phenomenal, and we hope that that continues to move ahead, and we'll be able to report on that at the next year's annual report.
Are there sounds any like questions? Alamance County has the right representative.
I don't know about that.
How long is your how long is your term? How long is your term?
I want to say you guys appointed me for 3 years.
No, we need to just bring it right.
I don't know about that. This has been a Miss Massey does join us in some of those meetings.
I am on the consortium.
And you all are invited. We meet in Randolph County. We used to meet four times a year, so quarterly, and they have upped it since we've moved with two additional counties. We feel there'll be more sharing and partnership where we meet. I want to say it's bi-monthly now, so we'll get to see each other's faces
so
a lot more.
Can you say again the counties that are part of this group now?
Alamance County, so we'll go first, because and we won't say it's alphabetical, we'll just say we're the best. Orange County, Randolph County, and the new two counties are Moore and Montgomery.
Very good. Any questions for Cheryl? And thank you for sharing
thank
that
you
report.
So much
we
for having
we did
me.
Get a copy of it
great.
In advance.
And Cheryl, I did see that presentation.
It was fabulous,
a burning glass.
Wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was, mm-hmm. We're very excited. I made the second. So that motion, I
want
to see it, but it's
fabulous. I didn't make a motion, but I did see that presentation.
Fabulous.
So,
thank you, Cheryl.
Thank you.
Time now for the 2010-2011 annual report workforce investment. Oh, that was what we just did, wasn't it?
Alamance.
I wanted to hear it again, Cheryl.
Yeah.
The Alamance Alliance update. And let me just, Gary, before you come forward, we appreciate y'all being here, but if you really do want to go and have other things to do, we won't be offended. So don't feel like, yeah, we normally get out here between 11:30 and 11:45. You're fine.
Makes us look good, this young girl.
Thank y'all for coming.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you.
My granddaughter is a junior at Elon. Her
really?
Name is Amber Massey. I don't know if any of you
I haven't heard that.
Yeah, she worked in the school store or something, so. But she,
oh, cool.
Her mom, Felicia, is also works there.
So, oh, my gosh. Uh-huh. Connections.
She's in student affairs, so I'm into Elon.
Oh, great. Thank you so much.
And you can see.
Well, you all know what our events are for the rest of February, so thank you so much.
Thanks. Okay, Gary, I'd like to welcome Gary Ander and Dr. Christina Christopoulos, the Alamance Elias Update. Did I say that right?
Perfect.
Okay. Actually, you know, when I saw that, I was thinking about Zach DeLupis, so I know I had to be close. So, Gary, welcome.
It's a pleasure to be here, Commissioners, Chairman Manning. And I'm really excited to stay till about 11:45 this evening with you all.
Watch it.
You'll be alone.
No lights.
I appreciate you taking the time to allow us to give a brief update on the progress of the Alamance Alliance. We have just started our fourth year of a six-year grant, and our plan is to give you a little background both on infrastructure development and on specifically outcome data. And this new outcome data that we have, I think, is really exciting, and Dr. Christopoulos will provide that outcome data as she is our primary evaluator from the Duke Center for Child and Family Policy. And let's see. So as you know, preparing Alamance County for a prosperous future begins with the recognition that our youngest citizens must get what they need today to become the adults who will strengthen our community and build our economy right here in Alamance County. As we all know, really, it's those children who are our greatest asset in Alamance County. We have lots of partners who are working with us in Alamance County and in North Carolina to make our grant and the work that we're doing with young children as successful as possible. And you'll notice most of these are from Alamance, but we also have the Greensboro Children's Development Service Agency, and then the Duke Center for Child and Family Policy, where Dr. Christopoulos is located, the National Center on Child Traumatic Stress, North Carolina Families United, and the Duke Center for Child and Family Health are major partners with this grant. We also have lots of local committees working on this grant, including the Children's Executive Oversight Committee that Commissioner Massey sits on. So the success of our grant is not just from the few folks who are paid grant employees, but it's the entire community working together, working as a system, because there's not one agency in our community that makes for successful children and families. It's our entire community and our entire community working together. Again, you know, there's two major facets of this grant, and one is on infrastructure development. I mean, this is long-term infrastructure development to make sure that there is in place the capacity to treat young children and their families who have social emotional concerns, and that those will be there long after our grant is gone in less than 3 years. The other particular piece is that we're providing direct services for children and their families. So I'm going to talk to you again a little bit about our infrastructure development, those big picture things that we're doing. So we have trained over 800 professional staff, child care providers, parents, members of the community to understand early childhood social emotional development, early brain development, and the effects of trauma on young children. We now have 7 evidence-based early childhood mental health practices that are being conducted in Alamance County. When we started, there was 1. So there's a huge capacity to treat these children that was not here before we began our work. We've trained over 50 professional staff to screen young children for emotional concerns. Over 400 children have been impacted by the incredible years for teachers, who have been trained to work with 45 childcare instructors in this evidence-based practice. 134 parents have actively participated in an Incredible Years parenting program. This is for children with behavioral concerns. And 44 childcare teachers in over 23 facilities have had on-site mental health consultation from our early childhood mental health consultant. 69%, or 237 out of 343 referred children to the Alamance Alliance have received comprehensive in-home mental health assessments. Those are two-hour assessments done by a child psychologist sitting on the floor with kids, interviewing parents, pretty extensive. 166 of those children have been enrolled in the Alliance and have been referred to mental health treatment or presently receiving mental health treatment. And over 83%, or 138 of those enrolled families, have a family partner who are working with them. This is our initial numbers kind of data. But it doesn't really speak to the outcomes that we're getting for children and families in Alamance County. And that's what's really important here, is to see what are we doing, what are the long-term effects. And so Dr. Christopoulos is going to talk about those childhood outcomes.
Thank you so very much for having me here today. And I will show you a little bit of what we have found in terms of the outcomes for the families that are participating in the Alliance. The evaluation of the project has numerous components. What I'm going to do today, though, is present you with some information that we collect from the families themselves. So we interview the families that we invite all the families that have been enrolled in the Alliance to participate in the evaluation, because we need feedback to see how they feel about everything, the services they're getting, as well as to see whether they see improvements in their children's behavior. So today, what I'm going to do is share with you some information about the children that have come into the Alliance, and then some of the outcomes for the children and the parents. The children have come to the Alliance with all kinds of different problem behaviors. And as you see, about three quarters of them, 74%, have come in with disruptive behaviors. And what we mean by that is aggressive kinds of behaviors, severe defiance, acting out a lot, impulsivity, recklessness, and so forth. As you see, there are a lot of children that have hyperactive and attention problems, kids with sleeping problems, they can't fall asleep, they wake up in the middle of the night, children with persistent noncompliance, they are not listening to their parents, they're not listening to their child care providers, they get kicked out of child care because of that, excessive crying, and then children that also have anxiety problems. They are very afraid to leave their mother, they cling to her, and so forth.
That was old age, you've done that.
I'm sorry?
I thought that was old age.
I guess it starts and ends with those. All right. Here's our first slide that gives us some information about children's behaviors in school and disciplinary actions. As you see there, the second column that says intake on the top, that is what happened when the children first got enrolled in the Alliance. And what we see is at that point, in the 6 months prior to that, 11% of those kids were suspended, 5% of those children had been expelled, and then 5% were suspended and expelled at the same time. 6 months after they've entered the Alliance and have gotten services, you see that only 6% have been suspended, and none of them have been expelled or suspended and expelled at the same time. So that's a great thing to be able to see. All right, and this is my first slide about the children's outcomes. What I want you to see here is this is an instrument. We ask the parent how the child is doing, and it assesses behavioral and emotional strengths in children. And the dark blue column that you see there is the percent of children that scored in the average or above average range when they first came into the Alliance, and the light blue is what happened 6 months into the program. So as you see, all of those kinds of constructs are getting better. So the kids are starting to show more behavioral and more emotional strengths 6 months after they have come into the Alliance. This is for the very, very young kids. This is up to age 3. And this is the same instrument for children that are 3 to 5. So a little older, but again, you see the same very positive trends. Kids are doing better at school. They are doing better emotionally. They're developing, they're seeing themselves as more competent. So we are starting to see some good results. The next slide is looking at, is an instrument that is looking at the types of behaviors that act as protective factors for the kids. So for example, a child that has a good relationship with one of their parents, that can act as a protective factor against negative experiences that the child will have. The same thing with self-control. A child that knows how to appropriately respond to a situation is that's a protective factor for them. They are going to do better in other kinds of negative situations. So again, what you see here is you're seeing some increase in all of these kinds of behaviors that are protecting their kids against other negative experiences. All right, this is our another instrument that we are using, but this one now is looking at behavioral and emotional difficulties. So what you're hoping to see, you're hoping this behavior now to go down instead of go up, all right? And that's exactly what you see. The internalizing behaviors are things like depression, when they have psychosomatic symptoms, they have headaches and they don't have a reason for them, things like that. Whereas externalizing behaviors are behaviors like aggression, acting out, destroying things, having temper tantrums. So you see that both of those kinds of behaviors are coming down, and there's a very dramatic decrease is actually in the externalizing kinds of behaviors. Now, the next slide is the same instrument, but it gives you a little more detail. The first few columns on the left are the internalizing behaviors that we were talking about. And then the attention problems and the aggressive are the two that make up the externalizing behaviors. So again, as you see, even in this more detailed kind of slide, you can see that the kids are getting better, both in terms of internalizing behaviors and externalizing behaviors. And as you see, the aggressive behavior has a pretty huge kind of decrease again. And now let's move to parents, those who are outcomes for the children. And now I'm going to give you a little bit of information about how the parents are doing. This is an instrument that is looking at stress levels for the parent. And as you can imagine, a child that has a parent that has a child with serious issues can be very, very stressed. So what we are starting to see again is decrease in the stress levels of the parents. The parents are starting to see their relationship with their child getting better. They're feeling better about that. And they are starting to perceive their child as more manageable, less difficult, which is a good trend to see. And hopefully, we are going to be doing interviews with these families every 6 months for 2 years. So this is at 6 months only. So we're going to see them again at 12 months, at 18 months, and 24 months. So hopefully, we will see some more results as we move on. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Christina.
Do we have questions? For either Gary or, well, I was going to say Dr. Christopoulos.
You can call me Christina. That's what I call her.
Thank you. I can throw away my accents now.
I'm sorry. I call her that.
Questions or comments?
Yeah, we certainly will entertain questions.
Well, I'd just like to make a comment because I had seen this recently. And one of the parents got up, and I think what I'm seeing through what she said is how much this is helping them and their parenting skills as well as working with the children and how that helps her in the next child she has or if a friend has an issue and how to connect and so forth. So I think we'll see a lot more results out of this than just the research you did right here.
Yeah. I think you're exactly right, Commissioner. I mean, when we're working with really young children, we're really working with dyads, with caretakers and young children. Mm-hmm. And so if you have an effect on this child, you also have an effect on other children in that family.
Well, you know, I worked in DSS for 12 years, and I'm honored to be on this board, by the way, because I saw a lot of the same things that happened. They happen in every county. It's not just our county, but our county is doing something about it, and that's what makes me so proud of our county. So I'm thrilled to be on the board with you guys, so and also on the executive board. So it's just an honor for me to be on it. I just wanted to tell you.
We're appreciative of your support.
Thank you.
Commissioner Massey, and the support of the county commissioners in general.
I have a couple of questions, and I hope they won't be perceived as trite or disrespectful. I'm happy for anything that we can do for people that need help. But I have to ask a question or two about the finances of this grant. How much longer are we going to be in the grant, theoretically, technically? We've been in it 3.5 years, according to the last expense sheet that I
have. Right, so we have a little more than 2.5 years left.
2.5 years. Unless I've added wrong, I very well could have, we have paid Duke $1.3 million through 3.5 years to do what they've done, or out of the grant. The grant has paid that. In the next 2.5 years, what do you suspect that they'll be paid technically?
Initially, and you noticed on our slide when we looked at partners, you know, we are working with two Duke organizations. One is the Center for Child and Family Policy, which is our evaluation. And our evaluation has to continue throughout the course of the 6 years, and it's mandated, and it's very, very, very comprehensive in nature. The other center is the Duke Center for Child and Family Health, and they had been our trainers, and they are the experts in early childhood mental health for North Carolina and probably for pretty much the entire East Coast. This is actually a relatively new area, so there aren't a ton of training institutes. So our initial large payments to the Duke Center for Child and Family Health had to do with those training pieces that we utilized during primarily our second and third years. So we have very little in the budget for additional training going forward. Again, our contract with the Center for Child and Family Policy will continue for evaluation. So it's dramatically down. So it, over the next 3 years, including this year, it's a little over $600,000.
Okay. So the grand total will be right at $2 million, is that correct?
Probably so.
Okay, and just for the sake of information, because I think everybody from the federal government all the way down to the local level needs to know how tax dollars are being spent and whether or not they're cost effective and or inflated or so with that said, with this $2 million, if they could explain exactly, if they could, or you exactly, I understand they have to have a profit, so to speak, to stay open. Awesome. I mean, wherever their office is down at Duke. Are you by chance part of the Terry Sanford Institute or whatever that is at Duke?
We are part of the Center for Child and Family Policy.
Is that part of the Terry Sanford?
It is, but it's also independent. Right now it is.
It's really an independent arm. It's an independent center within the institution.
Okay. Of the Terry Sanford?
No.
Oh, of not. Okay.
Okay. There are people within the center who also have faculty appointments that are in the Sanford School, but the center itself is an independent body.
I'm familiar with that, with the Sanford Institute. Of the $2 million, this study and all that you've done, is that, can you give a ratio of what actually went into the actual pay for performance versus the overall budget of your center or your operation? Can you give any idea as to the percentages here?
I guess I'm not exactly sure of the question relative to pay for performance.
Okay, did
versus
it take $2 million? Is it gonna take $2 million to do what we're doing as far as the actual pay for work?
so to speak.
And I mean that with all due respect. I'm not trying to be disrespectful at all. I know we have to have the studies. I know we have to do what we're doing here, the analyses and so forth. But does it take $2 million? In other words, what we've done to date, has it really cost $1.3 million to get somebody to do that? That's what I'm trying to say, short of there being some excess involved. I think that's a pretty clear question.
You know, we're contracting with experts in the field to do their work. I would hope that, although I recognize that these are large amounts of money, that we are getting what we pay for. Again, you know, there are not a lot of places to get these services, Commissioner. So, you know, we're utilizing the folks who actually helped to write the grant and who were partners from the very beginning of the grant. This grant was accepted by the federal government. It was funded by the federal government. They knew who the applicants were, who were the team, the participatory team members who wrote the grant. So, you know, at the federal level, those funders acknowledged that it was appropriate, and those all go in with a budget, and you know our budget goes in this month for the federal budget year 2012-13. So you know it's done way in advance. You know, I agree, Commissioner, that the cost of some of these things may seem to some of us to be relatively exorbitant, but I think that they're in line with other organizations that are providing these services to the other grant members. You know, there's about 80 of these grants across the country right now that are in different years of development, but almost every one of the grants have their evaluators at a prestigious university. I mean, that's where the major evaluation for these are done. So,
well, mere academic but theoretical question is, do you feel like there is some, there's a word for it. In other words, they know, not Duke per se, but other institutes know that, okay, if we get grant money, we can do what we do. We can thrive off of the grant, and it's just a vicious cycle. You know how I feel about this whole scenario
right,
to start with.
Right.
I just believe it. All these people possibly could have been interviewed by professional people. You say they're not out there, but I believe the feds should look more into how the grant money's been spent and what we're getting, what the citizens are getting, what bang they're getting for the dollar. I think $1.3 million in 3.5 years for what I believe has been done, technical, legwork, paperwork, interviews, so forth, is exorbitant. And, you know, our country is bankrupt as it is, and to further endorse exorbitant scenarios, I think doesn't speak well for management, as far as I'm concerned. But I appreciate your forthright answer, and appreciate you hearing me out.
Yeah. Gary, how many people do we have from Duke? We have several people from Duke that are working with this grant. And I think we're honored to have this big grant in Alamance County myself, so to help the kids of Alamance County. But we have, what, 6 or 8 or how many people from Duke?
Well, with evaluation, how big's your team, Christina?
Yeah, Christina.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but they're not full-time. So it's 2 people at the – there's 1 FTE at the PhD level that we have, mm-hmm. and we have 2.2 additional FTEs to do the whole evaluation. And actually the evaluation, the grant requires evaluation to be up to 20% of the budget. And we are up to 10%. We are at the 10% right now. So actually for the evaluation piece, I can't speak for anything else because that's all I know. I can tell you we are under budget. And I can give you, I have prepared for you if you would like to see exactly what the evaluation entails. I have prepared something for you if you want to look at it. I'll be glad to share.
Yeah, and I just wanted to know, you know, I know that all of this is federally mandated, whatever they do.
Yes, it
it's
is.
It's federally mandated, yeah. And we don't have a choice as long as we keep the grant. We have to do whatever they tell us to do. Mm-hmm. So.
And the national evaluation, I mean, this it's mandated.
Thanks,
it's very extensive. When they go out and interview families, it's a two-hour interview with 13 validated instruments.
And we have to do a total of 1,100 interviews. Just think about it, they have times 2 hours. So it's a very extensive kind of evaluation.
So, and that's the national evaluation. Then they're doing all kinds of local evaluation pieces. So it is extensive. And I understand, Commissioner, that it sounds like a lot of money. It is a lot of money. But again, they're mandated pieces of this grant.
Well, I still say, and I have to say it again, it looks like to me a business could do this. Public policy or institutes, colleges, government, they can't seem to say it this way. But a business could tell you of that $1.3 million, how much it actually cost them to do it, and how much actually was a part put into their kitty, so to speak, general fund for future. They might not even have anything to do with our county. That's all I'm asking, and I think it's a reasonable question. I understand everybody's point on this, but I hope, and I think y'all understand mine.
Actually, one point of clarification is that actually Duke gives us a major break on their overhead. So, you know, in all these budgets, there is an overhead expenditure. And if you would look at the specific breakdown of the budgets, their overhead is 8% to us, and their general overhead on grants is
57.
So they give us a break.
one thing that might be of interest, the part of the program that you're talking about was done through the Duke Center for Children and Family. It's actually a consortium of Duke, the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and North Carolina Central University. That is a freestanding, I mean, it's housed at Duke because it has to have somebody to manage the payroll. But it actually is a consortium of those three institutions that came together and put money together, and the money that they put together for creating the center with these kind of grant monies. So it's, as you ask about the Sanford School, it's not part of that the academic institutional structure, but is this consortium freestanding of those three institutions, and each of us contribute to it. And these grants help sustain the work of the center.
Thank you, Gary.
Thanks,
thank
Gary.
You all for being here. Okay, we have two items 9 and 10, a budget amendment, and also a request to set a public hearing that our planning manager, Jason Martin, will present. Jason, good evening to you.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, commissioners. In your packet, you should have a memorandum from me to Amy Weaver, our finance officer, with Craig Honeycutt and Susan Osborne copied. What we're requesting is a budget amendment in the amount of $8,309. This is for transfer of the Work First Employment funding under the Rural Operating Assistance Program grant from the Social Services budget over to the Planning Department's budget. The reason on that is that the Planning Department oversees the EDTAP, Elderly Disabled Assistance portion, and the Rural General Public portion, the other two arms of that particular grant, and this is just putting all of it in line, so all the reporting goes through one place.
Some of this money go to Acton?
The Employment Work First does not. Right now, Alamance Community Services is administering that portion of the money, and it's being used to do car repairs for folks that are on the Wheels to Work program. And that's coordinated with Social Services as well. And I don't know, Amy, if you had anything you wanted to add.
Any questions for Jason about the budget amendment? Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Thank you, Eddie. Thank you, Linda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
And commissioners, you should also have in your packets a memorandum from me regarding a request to set a public hearing for some subdivision ordinance amendments. And I do have a very brief presentation that I'm going to give right now. On November 10th of 2011, the Planning Board voted unanimously to recommend approval of a series of amendments to the subdivision ordinance. Specifically, there were three sections of the subdivision ordinance, and also in your packet, you should have a copy of those proposed amendments that are highlighted in yellow with the parts that are being taken out stricken. That section 62, streets and roads, requiring lots with interior roads to have access on the interior roads. Section 64, private roads, an amendment reducing the number of lots allowed to access a private road to 8 from 14, which is the current rule. The allowing of a professional engineer to certify road plans in lieu of a staff inspection. Also an amendment requiring the person doing the subdividing to file their maintenance agreement, road maintenance agreement, with the planning department at the same time that the plat is recorded. Not necessarily recorded at the Register of Deeds, but so that we have something on record. The elimination of Class 1 private roads and then the unbuilt private road sections of the ordinance, and requiring private roads be built to Class 2 standards, which I'll elaborate on in a second. Requiring waivers for future lots off of non-conforming, pre-existing non-conforming private roads, and a change in just the language with regards to double frontage lots to say that it's prohibited, which is what the intent, I believe, of the ordinance was. And then also Section 66, prohibiting the use of flag lots along state highways such as 87, 49, 54. And many of these are also in the land development plan that was adopted in 2007, and some of them actually date back to Destination 2020 as well. And the Planning Board did adopt a statement of plan consistency at the end. So I'll just kind of jump right in, which I just covered that. The amendments were proposed basically to address public safety. Spent a lot of time speaking with the Sheriff's Department, EMS, and the Fire Marshal's Office to ensure that private roads are adequately maintained and that our emergency personnel are able to have adequate access to these roads in case of an emergency. To minimize expansion of non-conforming private roads. And then also sound planning practices, prevention of multiple driveway cuts in a row when that can be avoided by interior lot access. And the clearly defined requirements, there was some ambiguity in the ordinance to prevent confusion between staff, surveyors, developers, and so on. So just to kind of highlight what, put a visual to what I'm talking about, under Section 62, this is just a typical subdivision map here, two roads coming off of the state road. You can see the intersection. What we're saying with the interior access is that instead of on the state road having driveway, road cut, driveway, have the two lots access that interior road limit down to one access. Same thing with the interior road to the main subdivision road, the main collector of the subdivision. Just a sound planning practice, something that we recommend in technical review meetings, and most of the time the developers do this anyhow. Just to give you a visual of what a Class 2 private road looks like, this is an actual, I can't think of the exact name of this road, but this is a road in the county that's Class 2 standards. Travel way is approximately 18 feet wide versus Class 1 private road, which is a 10-foot travel way. Both require a 50-foot right-of-way for the road. This is another good example. This is actually down in the southern part of the county. The road originates in Chatham County, and it extends on into Alamance County. And this is an excellent example, actually, of a Class 2 private road. Very well maintained, very well designed. Very clear with the ditches there, and a good travel way. And this is a Class 1 private road. When it was built, it would have had a 10-foot travel way initially. And what you see over time is that with the natural wear and tear of the road, it will inevitably narrow down to about 8 feet, sometimes 9, but typically it falls less than 10. And the issue there with emergency personnel and just traffic in general is it makes it very difficult for two cars to pass along that. Unbuilt private roads, in our ordinance, any law, any development for with a road that is designed to access less than two lots, two or fewer lots, is what is considered an unbuilt private road. It's kind of an internal term. It's not actually in the ordinance. Basically, the road does not have to be built to any standard or inspected, as long as it's accessing two or fewer lots. And so this was an example, actually, of one that's on the ground. Now, it has been built up a little bit and upgraded a little bit. And this particular site plan gives you an example of a double frontage lot. At the front of the road, lots 1 and 2 are the access off of the unbuilt private road. Those lots are under 10 acres. Anything over 10 acres is exempt by state law. So it does not count to the road number, the number of lots accessing the road. Lot 3 actually has double frontage. Now, they would record something on the plat stating it's going to access the state road and not the private road. But the design possibly could have been avoided. Everything at the back, all those lots are over 10 acres. Non-conforming private roads, right now, if there is a lot that can be identified on a 1974 aerial or by deed or plat or something prior to the adoption of the subdivision ordinance in 1972, can be considered a non-conforming private road. Those can have lots cut off of them once every 2 years. There's no cap on the number of lots that can be cut off of that over time. This is an actual non-conforming private road in the county right now. And this is just an aerial photo. You can see that is about, I wish Dave Leonard was here today. Dave and I actually drove that in his truck. I believe it's about a half a mile back there, and there's about five lots that are cut out over time across that. Very, very difficult to navigate, a lot of potholes and things like that. Basically, it's a mud road. When I refer to a flag lot, this is a traditional flag lot with a flag pole that opens up at the back. This one, there's maybe a slight mapping error in our GIS, but it has 60 feet of road frontage, and it's generally maintained within the flagpole width. Like I said, that the flagpole may be a slight mapping error there, but that's what we're talking about when we say flag lots. And here's an example of one where the minimum width is not maintained. That's another proposed amendment, is that on flag lots at 60 feet be maintained all the way back within the flagpole portion. This starts out at 60 feet and narrows down and then opens up again at the back. And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions that you all have of me at this time. Staff is recommending that a public hearing be set, if it's the board's wish, for March 5th at 7 p.m. And, Mr. Chairman, I'd also like to introduce Chairman Bill Griffith of the Planning Board and Vice Chairman Ray Cobb, who will be also glad to answer any questions, if you have any questions for them.
Welcome to both of you. Thank you for what you're doing.
We really do. Thank you.
March 5th, Craig, does that date meet your scheduling?
Yes, sir.
Any questions for Jason? Do we need a motion for that date?
I'll make a motion.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Linda. Any other questions for Jason or Bill or Ray? If not, all in favor say aye. Any opposed? Very good.
Thanks,
thank you,
sir.
Jason. Thanks for the presentation.
You're welcome.
Craig, do we have any county manager reports this time?
None this evening, other than I have a bad cold. So
Don't go in the room. It's right.
Really?
At this time, I'd like to move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143-318-11A6, to consider the qualifications and conditions of appointment or conditions of initial employment of a public officer or employee. I put that in the form of a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Any discussion or questions before we go?
Yes, sir.
Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? We'll go that way. And we
won't be long.
Okay.